Hello and welcome to the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, episode 255. Tonight we have two reviews for you, La Familia Hort and Stonespine Architects. But first, we start off with the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games we've been playing lately. This episode made possible by our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. For links to everything we talk about in the show, head over to our show notes at tabletopbellhop.com/episode255. Links in our show notes may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing, but help support the production of this show. Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games we've played lately.
So up first was some Friday night gaming with Sean at the Chapter 2 Brewery, starting with a game of Stonespine Architects. Now, Deanna and I talked about this one quite a bit last week in our Bellhop's Tabletop segment, and we are going to be reviewing this later. So this was the first time Sean played, though. So is there anything you want to say before we get to a full review?
This one kind of shocked me because, unlike Cartographers, it was dead simple to play. It's not a simple game, not an easy, basic, you know, party game. It was just that easy to play. Between the ability to have those reference cards available and just the way everything laid out, the iconography, it was, to me, so far of the ones I've played, the most approachable and easy to learn of all the role player games.
Yeah, and this being I'm trying to think, maybe my third play, my fourth play. Well, there was no surprises here. The game is solid and it continues to play quickly and smoothly.
Yeah, the only thing I'll note that I definitely, at this point, having now tried it 3-4 players, I definitely prefer them all to 2-player. 2-player wasn't bad. Deanna and I tried 2-player. It was okay. But I think it's definitely more enjoyable with more. Up next, we played a couple of games of La Familia Hort. Not La Famiglia, not to be confused with La Famiglia that we reviewed in the past. This is a similar sounding game, La Familia Hort. This is a spooky gardening game from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. It's a nice, casual, family-friendly game where the mechanics tie in well with the theme, and to me, your action just makes sense. Now, there is one piece of iconography that could be better, but other than that, I've really enjoyed this one. I dig the theme. So in this, your kids being haunted by your grandma, who will give you her entire estate because, note, your grandma's dead. So it's a ghost who's haunting you and who basically shows up and said, whoever can make the best, tend my garden the best, will award with our whole estate. It's got awesome artwork that kind of looks like Edward Gorey, really looks like Gorey to me, but also some Tim Burton aspects there. There's some with the new Beetlejuice movie coming out. Maybe it's timely that we're talking about this one because I think there's definitely some feel there.
It's funny, and maybe this is just the goth influence of my family and friends on me, but this doesn't feel spooky Halloween to me at all. It's one of those things where, yes, there are ghosts and things, so it works perfectly well in the Halloween theming, but it's really more just kind of goth, dark, cool. It's one of those things. Is Edward Scissorhands a Halloween movie? Technically, it's a Christmas movie.
Yeah, I was going to say it's a Christmas movie.
but really, it's that kind of aesthetic as opposed to specifically, you know, Halloween themed.
Yeah. It's got that spooky season vibe, like cute and dark. But I will admit, if you ask me for Halloween game recommendation list, this is not the first thing that would pop into my head.
Oh, see, for me, it does. Like it's even what you're growing. You see, you're growing pumpkins and squash are two of the vegetables you can grow. And the scarecrow looks, to me, it is. To me, so this is
when you come to me and say, I'm putting this on a Halloween list, to go, oh, okay, that can be there. Sure. Yeah. But would it ever pop into my head? I wouldn't have thought of it on my own. That's where that sits.
Fair enough. Yeah. To me, it goes on the list. It'll be at our event, our Halloween themed event at the Walkerville Brewery this year. So if you want to check it out. Now, we did play one game with the asymmetric advanced rules. I personally felt any gamer who's even a game of Ticket to Ride's probably enough that you could just start with the advanced rules. But then Sean was the one that actually said, no, let's try the basic game just to see. Mm-hmm. So I'm glad we did that because honestly, it did have a little different feel. There was a different aspect to it. I dig this game. In talking about biases earlier this episode, Mark himself, the owner of Grand Gamers Guild, actually taught Deanna and I at GAMA Expo. And it seemed good, but honestly, it was very late at night at a very busy con, and we were kind of exhausted. And I hadn't actually read the rule book myself at that point, so I, having then sat down, read the rule book and broke it out here at chapter two, I just found it like super easy to teach. I thought being able to explain it by the theme, like this is one, like everyone used to always accuse me of talking about games, but purely about mechanics and not theme. No, this one, the theme is part of it. And to me, the gameplay was very intuitive because like it's a farming game and you're watering plants and they take multiple seasons to grow. And if you fertilize them, they're worth more. We also, just to kind of mash in all our plays for one, so we're not talking about one game, another game, and going back to the same one. We also introduced this to Brenda and Gwen on the weekend and both enjoyed that as well. Surprisingly well, actually, it went over, especially after being kind of burnt out after the first game we played. We fit in two games on Sunday.
Yeah, this one for me really fits into that sort of casual game. You can easily chat and be discussing things while playing this game. Even more so if you play on the non-asymmetric sides, a little more thought when you're playing the asymmetric side. But yeah, if you just want to sit down, you know, have a few coffees or something with some friends and play a game, this one fits in great.
I actually like that Sean made us play the base side because I probably wouldn't have tried it otherwise. Yeah. And something about that game, because we were all on an even playing field, made it just feel tighter. I don't know. I didn't expect to like it. I usually like asymmetry. I expected to go, why did we sit through that? But overall, I like how quickly it plays, and the game is it's tight. It's a tight game. I like the timing aspect where you're flipping up the weather cards, and the first card is set, and then after that it's random. And once you flip up three Blood Moon cards, the game's over. So if you happen to flip over three in a row, the game could be done in round four, or you might end up playing the longest game possible, which would be six rounds. And you're planting things are going to take multiple rounds to grow before you can harvest them. So is it even worth making long-term plans? And that's, you know, once you've played the game a bit and you're aware of that variable length, you end up adapting your gameplay so that you change what you're doing based on how much you want to push your luck that the next card won't end the game. So I like that aspect. I found that really interesting.
Now, we probably could say more, but we've got a detailed review sitting on deck. So check that out for more information on this spooky tile layer.
Yeah,
or Goth gardening long. Game. Up next is another game we've got a review copy queued up. So it just ends up that like everything we're talking about tonight, we're reviewing also. So it just happened to work out that way because we kind of like dove into some games and like played a bunch this last week and a bunch of the same games in a row, which doesn't always happen. So what we have next to talk about, sorry, I said a review queued up. It's going to be a preview, is Estate Raise the Realm from Grodd Games. Now, I know we've talked before about how we do not tend to do Kickstarter previews, and we kind of sworn off on them for various reasons. But Catherine Hahn, one of the designers of the game, is actually a fan of our podcast and reached out and actually did the research. Like they were like, hey, we read your review policy and everything. So that was impressive. But even then, we're like, oh, we got a backlog. We got stuff going on. But what they pointed out is, hey, are you going to be at Origins? And we're going to be at the Media First Look. So we actually got to see this one at the Media First Look at Origins. And at that point, it looked like a finished game. So we kind of broke our unwritten rule of not doing previews and decided to check out a prototype, which got played multiple times. We played two player, and then I played four player, and then played again two player the other night with Sean. So we've given this one a good breadth of plays with different player counts and different people. And I got to say, I do have some regrets here because the game is a prototype. And honestly, the day after the game showed up, we got an email with, oh, here's some rule updates and clarifications in the new copy of the rule book. And yes, the first couple plays were a little rough because the rule book is definitely not as clear as it should be at this point. Thankfully, though, the gameplay was solid enough and it's looking like it's going to be fixed. Like it looks like they're going to do the work to improve it. And I think this could be a hit, assuming they fix some of the issues.
Yeah, unfortunately, one of our biggest problems and the reason that we have tended to stay away from the preview, the pre-Kickstarters, the not finished games, is people don't do enough blind playtesting. These are games that work. If the designer is teaching you the game, if the designer is giving you all the unwritten parts that aren't in the rule book and nudging you in certain directions with your play and by the way they teach it so that your game experience is what they think the game experience should be. When we sit down, As we discussed in the ask, we aren't reaching out to the designers. We're sitting down with a rule book, read the rule book, play the game. And that's not the same experience that some of these playtesters have had, it seems to us.
Yeah, I'm going to be honest and say this has highlighted in a lot of ways why we don't do prototype previews. Yes. And even today, I got an email from the designer with rule tweaks. And it's great to know that they are addressing some of these rules issues. But on the other hand, I shouldn't have to go through email threads and errata to be able to play a game. And if we were to write them with all the questions that we had about it, we would just be doing like unpaid labor for prototyping, basically, you know. And it's a good game, and I'm glad that I got to try it. But I said it just, Mo was like, this was your fault. You picked it. And I was like, yes, I know. No more prototypes.
I hate to sound so negative because the game does look good. We'll get into a lot more detail in our full review about what we did like about it. But yes, this was not a finished game. And it's hard to preview an unfinished game.
And I feel like most of what we encountered here were rule book issues. Like, the rules are there. They just aren't always clear. And that coupled with some ambiguous card wording made for some frustration when we were playing. Yes. I don't think we're being unrealistically optimistic to say that this will probably have been ironed out before it hits full production. But
yeah. And like just little things, like there is nothing about start player passing or who starts the game or what happens between rounds to the start player. Sure, most games, start player pass to the left. But does it? Does it not? In this particular game, it seems like there's an advantage to going first because the market wipes. And you get that first chance at those new cards. So to me, it should pass. Was that correct? I don't know.
The rule book mentioned the start player token. Our box didn't include one. Yeah.
That's just a nice example. So we've kind of complained about it. Here's what the game is, okay? Worker placement, action selection, building a tableau of citizens and buildings in a fantasy medieval setting. That's super high level. It honestly feels inspired by a number of different games, like Agricola. There's some feeling there. And Wingspan, because there's rules for tucking cards and standing resources. And then there's also some set collection and tracks that affect. As you play cards, you go up on tracks that make your actions better later in the game. And then I thought that was all kind of neat. It's all stuff we kind of seen before, but putting it together in this combination is a little new. And there's quite a bit of game, but the game going on, but the game seems to flow really well. And like again, the actions kind of fit. Like you have to collect cards, so that like you have to have the blueprints basically, and then you collect the resources, and then you put them in your play, and then the more you have of them, the better you get, right? So again, check out the full review for a much more detailed look at the game coming to Kickstarter later this month.
Yeah, I mean, realistically, Mo, who had played the game and suffered through the learning curve early on, sat down, taught me the game in probably 10 minutes. I sat down and we didn't have a problem playing the game. Now, that's not right to say there aren't issues. There are some numbers on cards that are, I think, wrong and balance issues and things that need to be shifted around. But mechanically, what the game has going on, while not new, is an interesting arrangement of mechanics that I think makes for a good game if they get all the text on the cards and rule books and things right.
Next, this is one I assume most people are going to care about. Maybe I'm wrong. I think this is hype. This is new hotness. This is stuff people are excited about. And that is they each played once. I played twice because I played with each of them. Endeavor Deep Sea. First was with Deanna at the end of a date night, which probably wasn't the best choice. Second was with Sean at a coffee shop yesterday. So the first thing I have to call out about this game is it looks intimidating, like ridiculously, like Vital Lacerda. Oh my gosh. There's icons everywhere and they're tiny and there's so many of them and there's so many boards and look at all this stuff. And what are all these discs for? And what the heck is that board with all the hexagons on it and all the colors? But honestly, it's not that bad. Now you can see all this stuff. Check out our unboxing video just to see all the components and the boards, like so many boards. It's, I think, beats all records for every game I own for number of boards. It might even beat Gloomhaven for number of individual boards with the puzzle fit for Gloomhaven. Like, there are just so many boards. But honestly, it's all rather simple and elegant. which honestly I expected because this is Endeavor. This is a follow-up to Endeavor Age of Sail. Age of Sail also looks intimidating, but everyone I showed it to notes how easy it is once you get going. And Deep Sea is the same. I remember putting Endeavor in our 1 hour slot for the board game blitz, or sorry, the Great Canadian board game blitz. And everyone's like, there's no way we're going to get this game done in an hour. And then they play it and they're like, oh my gosh. Yeah. In an hour, I get a full detailed game. That's awesome. So like the fact that Deanna and I did manage to play through a full game after a date night was a good indication of how approachable it is. Sean also, I think, picked it up super quickly last night. It's just like, it's a big game. There's lots there, but it's super approachable.
Yeah.
Yeah. I struggled with this one, and I will say we had been out drinking and I was drunk when we sat down to play this game. And I looked at it and went, there's a lot going on here and there's a lot of very small icons. And I had a hard time, and Mo had to explain things to me over and over again. But personally, what I was struggling with was there's a lot of small icons, and it's the way the game lays out that many of them are way across the table. Now, with some familiarity, once I know the game, I'll probably be able to play it comfortably because I'll know, well, the little orange blob over there means X. But as a first play, and particularly not sober, it was terrible. So there we're talking about biases, right? And I could, at first, I could pick up the pieces. There's large pieces that you're forming your ocean out of, and pull them over here and look at it and go, yep, I can read all that. Okay, now I can put it back. But then you start getting your wooden bits are on them, so you can't pick it up and look at it, right? And there are things, I can make a move across the table, but I'm not going to be able to choose the optimal move across the table because I'm not going to be able to see all the icons to pick out the optimal move. And I will say my vision is more subpar than most humans. So it's a me issue, but it led to some frustration in a game that I was really looking forward to.
Next, I'm going to call it the theme for Endeavor Deep Sea. I love it. This game has one of the most non-confrontational, family-friendly, eco-positive themes I've ever seen. The goal in the game is to form a team of scientists to do and create the most positive benefit for the world's oceans. You're going to do this through exploration, diving, research, publishing papers, and improving your team. One of the things that is very strongly emphasized in this is that there's no exploitation. You don't even pull resources from the sea. The only resource in this game is research that you gather from doing dives and publishing papers and helping out the oceans.
Yeah, it's neat. I like the theming. I like the way it plays out. You end up exploring and building out tiles to form an ocean that has various depths. I think as much as 5 tiles down, but we didn't go that far. I think it would be different with more players. The thing to remember is that diving does not move you to dive down. Diving sends someone to go get research. The move action allows you to move your submarine up or down or sideways.
Now, to go along with this theme, there is no plastic in this game, which is pretty dang cool. And this is despite the fact that it comes with awesome game trays inserts, which are great for storing everything out, and big props for individual player trays. Always love that, where I can hand a player a tray and it has all their stuff in it. And you even have a place to put all the people you hire from the game are on this special tray. And that's actually a carryover from Age of Sail. It had a similar tray, but this time instead it's made of bagasse, which is a eco-friendly material that's from sugarcane extract. Plus, it actually, so far, I am impressed by this one possibly more than anything else. I've been carrying this game sideways to bring it out to like the coffee shop with Sean, and it's been fine. I have not had to sort everything once I open it up. Everything stayed in place.
Now, that's impressive. I was super impressed with the little personal player game trays. They're just neat. You should check out the unboxing video. I already mentioned it. It just dropped on YouTube earlier today. I'll put a link in the show notes.
Yeah, it was interesting. Again, because I didn't have the visual difficulty that D had, it really did kind of make sense and flow nicely. If you're able to see things, because there's limited number of actions you can take, and they're all right there on your people or on your cards, when, you know, for special moves and things like that, you really only have to learn a pretty small set of things, and if you can see them, it becomes easy at that point. I totally understand that why D is struggling with it, because there is a lot of iconography on this, and it is sort of, you know, a colored thing in a circle, which isn't necessarily the most visually useful.
It's thing. Not bad iconography. Like, it all makes sense and it's easy to remember what X does and what Y does, but it's just all tiny and there's a lot of it.
Yeah. Well, and some of the things, like the research ones, it's like a sort of a faint circle with a slightly different colored book in it. Mm-hmm. And I can see how that could be, and even just finding them on the board, because there's a lot of undersea life on the boards. Sometimes trying to find an unused research spot you wanted could be difficult, even without visual problems.
Now, just a kind of general overview for people who don't know the game, or, you know, didn't back the Kickstarter and weren't hyped about this and haven't looked at it. The basic game flow here is pretty simple. You hire a person to your team, and everyone picks from the same groups of people. You then collect discs, which you're going to then use to activate those members of your team to do actions like move your subs around, explore the map, add new boards, complete dives for research, publishing papers, and supporting animal conservation efforts. Now, many of the actions are going to increase your levels on these four tracks, and they're each tied to each of the rounds of the game. And those will let you hire better people, or when you move further, or you get more action tokens, or you get to take back more action tokens. And one of the things that I always find, and I've found this in both my plays, is you start off feeling like you don't have enough, like you can't do much. You're like, oh my gosh, you know, like the game's only six rounds. Like, you're just going to draft six people. You're like, we're never going to get anywhere or do anything. But then you have those big turns in round five and six where you're doing tons of things and moving everywhere and adding new tiles. And I love that feeling of escalation during the six rounds of the game.
Yeah, there's very much a ramp up element, and it feels very satisfying.
Yeah, the flow was interesting, and there are a number of scenarios you work with, and they vary. I was flipping through them as Mo was cleaning up parts of the game, and they really do direct you to try out different things, sort of. You know, certain scenarios you'll be focusing more up at the surface, and other scenarios you'll be pushed to dive deep in order to get your get your points and things like that. And they've really done a good job of sort of making the scenarios different enough. And I'm sure there's theming behind them. I admit I wasn't reading the theming on them, but they have, you know, worked that all in nicely so that you're doing something different and they've given you a reason to.
Yep. And the other awesome thing, I think, is every single scenario can be played three ways. You can play cooperatively, you can play competitively, or you can play solo. And I think that is awesome. Like, when you're playing competitive, again, you're first among equals. You're not like super cutthroat trying to battle each other. There's none of that, right? It's just the team that did the most to help during the scenario gets the win. I've now played the first scenario twice, both competitively, because I tend to prefer competitive play. And what was neat was how different each game felt, how different the game with Sean was than the game with D. The biggest thing in that one was conservation. There were no turtles to save in the game with Sean and I. There was very little ability to conserve animals in our game because we just didn't find habitats that had animals. And that's one of the end game scoring, is who conserved the most. So that was very different from the game I played with Deanna, where there was an island of turtles that was up the first game. And like, I don't even think we saved them all by the end. So that was interesting to see how the same game plays different. And then the game has 10 scenarios. So you get 10 different scenarios combined with the ability to play those three different ways. Combined with the fact that even in each scenario, it's not like it gives you a set map. Like, the first map gives you two starting tiles, an island next to it, and then a randomly drawn, you know, surface tile. From there, it's up to the players where they use their sonar and where the tiles come from. And as I mentioned earlier, there are a lot of boards in this game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, having only played that first scenario, like, it was engaging and fun. And if that was the entire game, I would still be sold. Even having had what I did outline at first as having had a bad experience learning and playing the game, I was still sold on it. I was like, this is good. I like it. But the fact that there's still more in that box to be discovered, that's pretty exciting. It's something to look forward to. I want to ask you guys a question. I'm curious what the point spread was between two of you, because Mo and I tied on our first game.
Wasn't it like two?
I am so just
close. 55 to 57 or something like that.
I am actually just pulling that up right now. We
it was pretty close.
It was. Games, Endeavor Deep Sea. It was 54 to 57.
So 3 points.
Yeah. So yeah, 3 points. It was it was definitely it's a tight game, and it's not a huge scoring game. You know, again, you're playing seven rounds and you're only coming up in, you know, in the 50s there. So it's a snug game for that. And I think I have to say, based on my one play so far, and looking through the expansions, if I had spent Kickstarter money for this, I'd be pretty happy with the game I got. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There is enough game here. Even if I only played through all the scenarios once with my game group, that's still a solid amount of game here.
I agree with Deanna. I think what we played last night is as good as many whole games I played.
Yeah.
I don't even need another scenario. I will happily play that scenario over and over again, easily 5 or 10 times, which is a lot of play nowadays out of one game. Yep. Having 10 scenarios is almost kind of ridiculous. Now, the thing is, there's 10 scenarios. There's 3 different ways to play. We also have the Kickstarter version. So thanks, Burnt Island Games, for that. So there's some expansion content to check out where you can play with the dolphins. You have to watch the YouTube video to get that joke. But like so far, the game is fantastic in so many ways. Like, I am really impressed. I feel really bad that I kind of forced Deanna to play after a date night, because having that bad first impression, I'm like, I loved it. I had a good time in that game, even though Deanna was struggling. I'm like, it was so good. And I really want to try with more than two players, because the big thing with two players is you really don't explore much. There's not a lot of board out there. But with everyone else taking up spots, you would have to use that sonar action more. You would have to explore more boards. And I don't know what it's called, the impact board, the board you put your stars on.
Impact.
Yeah. Would get very more filled up with more players. Because that was the huge change. Between Deanna and I, we almost filled the card, just the two of us, where Sean and I like touched a corner of it.
Yeah, no, I'm super curious to see how it goes with 3 or 4 players.
So yeah, there you go. First thoughts, Endeavor Deep Sea. Deanna hates how small the icons are. Too many of them on too many boards due to bad eyes. Sean and I both loved it. We can't wait to explore more, because it'll be a bit before we get to the full review, I think. I think we need to dive a little deeper before we can review.
Maybe I just need to find the right spot to sit at the table, or the right layout, the right table layout for it to work for me.
I will point out Table Hog. Those boards aren't small, but they're not big. Like, if they were bigger, it would just be terrible, because you end up 5 across, and that ended up taking up almost the whole table at a coffee shop, and we're sitting at a long table.
And it kind of has the potential to go 5x5.
Yes.
Like, so. Yep.
All right, final game played this last week. Sean wasn't involved in this one. This is another bar find. We played a game, Milton Bradley, published in 1981, called Inner Circle. This was sitting on a shelf at the cookie bar, and I spotted it on the way back from the washroom, and I brought it right back to the table, because this is a very toyetic game with a big red plastic base that you put 4 boards on top of, and each of these hexagonal boards is bigger than the one underneath, so like they stack from biggest to smallest. Now, each of these has a hexagonal pattern on it, which includes a number of holes that show to the board underneath. And each of the spots has pips on it to show how far you move. And there's less holes with each level, with the final board having only one hole, which leads right to the center of the board and a big shiny star, which you want to land on. So at the start of the game, you place an equal number of pawns on the outside edge of the board. And then players move their pawns. And the way you do this, you pick it up, you look at the pips, and then you have to move that many spaces on a straight line. You can jump over other pieces, but you can't move on to an occupied spot. Note, you can't see these when the pawns are on them. So that's actually a big part of the game, is remembering, especially at the beginning of the game when you're putting, what is it, 11 each? I remembered what about 2 of mine were. And even when you land on a hole and then the board flips up, I'm like, I have no idea what hole I landed on. So that's part of it. And then if you pick a pawn that can't move because whatever, it's the edge of the board or there's already people in, like you get to move 3 and 3 every direction's taken, you actually just lose a turn, which is like, shame on you for not remembering that was a 3. And the goal is to get your pawns in the holes. And once all the holes are filled on a board, you lift it up. And then, of course, everything that's not in a hole is now removed from the game. And then you go again until all the holes are filled and lifted up. And then the player who's in that final spot in the middle wins.
Yeah, I couldn't help but compare it to that Connect Four round multi-level where you turn the board game that we found at a different local bar. I can't remember the name of it. I liked that one better. This was just okay. I actually liked that other one to the point that I was like, I would like a copy of that. That's kind of neat. This, I was like, yeah, I played it. Cool. We're done.
So interestingly, Inner Circle was re-implemented in 1995 as the children's game The Mole in the Hole, and at that time was a Spiel des Jahres recommended game, child game of the year winner, Japan Board Game Prize best child game winner.
See, I liked it. I thought it was kind of brilliant. The big trick was that, yes, the first four was pretty simple. Like you put a pawn on the one that's next to the hole, right? Like you put a pawn on the four that's four away from the hole. But once you got deeper, it started to be like two to three moves. And especially like you're forced to be on the hole wherever the hole was. And you'd open it up and like, I can move three. I can't go anywhere. Oh my gosh, it's going to take me four moves with this one pawn to get there. And I got to hope my opponent doesn't see it or doesn't find a shorter path on their own. So I don't know. I thought it was pretty smart, though. I did worry that eventually you'd learn the board and then it may not be as fun.
See, I felt that you had to memorize that board for that game to be playable because, and the board is shrinking as you go.
Yep.
And so there's less, and you've got, okay, so you're going to pick it up and put it over there, and now you've revealed the board underneath, which is smaller, and it has the pieces that you placed into the holes on it, and then now it has all the free blank spaces that you've revealed, which you had no way of knowing ahead of time when you managed to get your red pawn into that hole, that you can remember it has a three on it, but where am I going with that three?
Yeah.
How you know, what is the next space over that I'm going to land on? I don't know. So you would have to have it memorized, particularly as you get to the smaller boards and there's less options. I felt not knowing what those spaces were going to be meant, you couldn't plan ahead until the board was revealed. So I was just like, eh.
See, I felt it the other way. I thought you wouldn't memorize what's underneath because that'd just be too hard. But and you wouldn't be able to because the board's turned.
Yeah, it turns.
You're going to put you can't memorize them. It's impossible. Like, that is by design. That part is by design because you're
supposed to rotate. That's true. It would turn. Rotate it. Because I was thinking, man, to be competent at this game, you would have to have it memorized.
No, I think the thing is that new board comes out, and then can you figure out the best pattern to get one of your pieces onto a hole as quick as possible for your opponent? Yeah. And to me, that gave it kind of a chess-like feel. Anyway, it was neat. I liked it. Deanna liked the other one better. I can't remember what the other one was called. Something like Circle Four or something like that. I honestly couldn't find. We talked about it in a previous episode. Well,
to me, that's not a chess-like feel. It's like each time you revealed. Now I'm playing a new game with you. It got smaller, and I might have an advantage because I managed to get more red pieces into that new game, and then smaller still. But like chess, like what I do at the very beginning is going to have more impact on the end. And you can see many more turns ahead to me in chess.
And now a message from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
So we've got some exciting news for you Holiday Hijinks fans out there. And honestly, more importantly, for the people out there that heard us talk about these games and rave about these games and review these games, but haven't actually picked up any yourselves.
The first thing you want to know is that there are three new games coming to the series. Listen to these titles, folks. We've got Leprechaun Larceny, The New Year Nightmare, and The Krampus Caper. And that is in addition to The Marriage Mix-Up, which was released at Essen. In total, that brings the number of games in the Holiday Hijinks series to an even dozen.
Now, here's the exciting part for new and potential fans. In addition to three new 18-card escape room games, we are happy to announce the Holiday Hijinks Collection, where you can get all 12 of these puzzle games in a collector's box.
Now, if somehow you missed us raving about these games over the last couple of years, just go check out our reviews on YouTube, on the blog, social media. My family loves these games. They're one-hour escape room experiences. And honestly, one of my favorite parts about these is that you don't have to destroy anything to play them. The pro tip here is put the cards in sleeves if it asks you to write on them. So once you finish these, you can pass them on to your family, friends, as a gift, give them to someone else. hide them on Christmas morning, hide them at your neighbor's house on Easter, and they'll be like, what the heck is this? I love the fact that you don't ruin them, like, because so many escape room games are one and done. These are one and done for you. You're not going to want to play them again, but you can easily give them to someone else.
So all of this, the new games and the collector's box, is going to be available through a new Kickstarter project that is launching on October 15th. And they're setting it up so that you're able to pick any single game, any combination of games, or the full collector's box to purchase. So that's pretty cool. The Kickstarter page is live now, and I encourage you to go and click the notify on launch button.
Granny Hortensia has died, and on the eve of the next blood moon, appears before her four grandkids and offers her entire estate to the one that can best keep her garden. That's the theme of La Familia Hort, a somewhat spooky gardening game.
This tile-laying game for 2 to 4 players by Ramiro Maroni, sorry about that if I got the pronunciation wrong, comes from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy and for teaching us the game to Deanne and I at GAMA Expo.
La Familia Hort is a quick-playing, easy-to-learn game that takes about half an hour to play. In the box, you get a basic game and an asymmetric advanced game. Due to the fact that there's no reading required, this is a great game for families with a recommended age of 8+.
Now, one of the most striking and enjoyable parts of La Familia Hort is the artwork from Esther Mendez. It's creepy, cool, and feels like a mashup of the aesthetics of Edward Gorey and Tim Burton. Components are mostly thick player boards and tiles, along with some wooden cubes. The rule book is clear and easy to learn from, and the iconography is great, except for one small exception being the arrows on the round cards. More about that in a bit.
So the goal of La Familia Hort is to be the grandchild with the most gardening experience by the time Grandma comes to visit on the third blood moon, which could come in as few as 4 rounds or as many as 6. Experience comes from upgrading your tools, feeding animals, and growing flowers. But you will need money for those things, which comes from selling vegetables.
You start the game by choosing a player board and by having everyone decide which side to use, the basic, where everyone's the same, or the more advanced asymmetric side. You also need to mix up all of the gardening tiles and shuffle the round cards. Then you hand the stack of round cards to the first player with the special first round tile on top. Finally, you give each player 7 coins and set their XP track marker to 0, and you're good to go.
Each round, including the first, starts with a number of tiles being added to the shared market. Then players buy tiles from the market one at a time until everyone passes, either because they don't want any tiles, the market is empty, or they've run out of coin.
Every purchased tile must immediately be placed onto your garden, which has 6 spots for different tiles. Next, players distribute fertilizer. Everyone's going to get a fertilizer cube that either fertilizes one of their own plants or a plant of a player next to them, which actually represents the random fertilization of animals. Which you do is based on the current round card. Each plant in the game has a spot to hold 1 cube, so they're either fertilized or they're not.
Next, players fill their well with water cubes. Again, it's based on the current round tile. Each plant has room to hold 1 or more cubes, but you can only add 1 water cube per plant per turn. Each player also has an apple tree on their board that can be watered, and they have their well, which can hold any leftover water cubes.
The last step each round is for players to sell things from their garden. Everyone must sell their fully watered plants. This is not optional. Plants that have been fertilized give a bigger reward than those not. Vegetables give you coins so you can buy more stuff from the market, whereas flowers give you experience, which is what you need to win the game.
Play then continues, with the stack of round cards being passed clockwise and a new one drawn. Keep doing that until 3 blood moon tiles are revealed, in which case you finish off that round and the game ends. Players then gain 1 experience for every 5 coins they have, and the player with the most experience wins. Ties are broken by leftover coins, then leftover water.
And that's all simple enough. What makes things interesting are the tiles in the market. These include vegetables that take up to 2 water and provide coins. The amount varies by veggie. For example, corn only takes 1 water, so you may sell it the round you plant it, and it costs 1 coin, It only generates one coin when sold unless fertilized, and then it gives you two. Radishes, on the other hand, cost two coins, but they give you three or four. Pumpkins will need two seasons to grow with two spots to water, but give you five or eight coins if they're fertilized. Flowers are similar, though the easiest flower takes two seasons to grow, and those all give you experience points instead of coins.
Then there are various animals and tools, like the bee that gives you two coins per round, but only if you have a flower in your garden, or the chicken that can eat one of your vegetables for points, but only if you've given it water.
Now, to add to the variability, there's actually two different market decks in the game. One you pull from on a normal round, and a separate one for those rounds when a blood moon comes up. Now, the blood moon veggies and flowers are all kind of twisted and evil looking, including the mandrake and snapdragons. And there's additional tools like the scarecrow that gives you one experience, the compost box, which generates fertilizer, a watering can, and the cutest evil goat you'll ever see.
Finally, there's the fact that the player boards are two-sided. On the advanced side, each character has a special ability. One character can put a coin on a market card, and when it's bought, they get the money instead of the bank getting the money. Another generates fertilizer each turn, but if they choose it, they also have to fertilize another player's crop. There's one that can water a single plant twice, but if they do so, they have to do the same for an opponent. And the last one can buy and sell experience points by spending four coins. In addition to this, players get bonuses for hitting different points on the experience track. Like when you hit a certain spot on the track, you'll gain bonus fertilizer or coins or water.
All of this leads to a lot of variety and replayability and more than one way to play the game. Mm-hmm. Flowers seem like the best way to get experience. You also get XP for your end of game coins, and we've seen someone win just by buying and selling veggies all game. Similarly, each tool you give gives you a point, and just by having things like a set of a watering can, a scarecrow, and a compost heap could be enough to tip the scales.
Scores in La Familia Hort tend to be pretty low and are always close. This is a game where a score of 15 is really good and probably will only happen if you don't draw that final blood moon until the last round.
Yeah, I'm finding most games were in that 10 to 12 point range and only a point or two difference between, say, first and second place, which really drives home how every little point you can eke out matters in this game.
Yeah, this is not a heavy game, showing about 1.25 on BGG for weight, and half an hour is pretty average time for this game, so you're in more and more filler territory, though it can run a bit shorter if those blood moons come up quickly, or longer if you've got people really taking their time and thinking through each purchase.
So, as we mentioned earlier, we actually learned this game from the owner of Grand Gamers Guild. He taught it to us at GAMA Expo in the hotel lobby of the hotel we were staying pretty late at night. And he just kind of broke it out, unboxed it, and said, "We're playing this." I'm like, "All right, cool." The first thing that drew me to it was that artwork. That artwork really is nice. I love the game, the look of this game. There's just something about that aesthetic that appeals to me. I don't know if it's the 90s goth in me or something else. I just really like the way this looks. And even the last time we played, I totally missed this until we played at Brenda's on the weekend. On the asymmetric side, the characters look angry and more serious, which amused me. I had totally missed that difference. And what I liked about that first play, and I do this whenever I'm teaching the game, is I don't mention that there's two different piles of tiles, because Mark did this, and you don't get to see the creepy stuff until the first blood moon comes up. And it's always neat to go from, yeah, there's plants and things, and like, what the heck is that dragon looking thing? And what is coming out of that fertilizer box? What is it with the creepy worm? And I really loved seeing the twisted veggies for the first time.
Yeah, the quirky blood moon plant art is great, and it was truly amusing flipping them over for the first time. And it is also cute how the base side is happy, the family-friendly side.
I found this game very easy to teach. It's a farming game, and you do the things you expect to do in a farming game, right? You're going to buy, I'm going to call it buy seeds, but you're buying like veggies and flowers, and you're planting them in your garden. And they're worth more if they're fertilized before you sell them. And some crops are easier to grow, and some things take multiple seasons to be able to grow them. And other things are ready right away. And it all just makes sense.
Yeah, the theme and the mechanics are tightly tied together so that the game just makes sense and is super easy to learn and to remember when you're playing it. It just flows.
Yeah, and what's interesting is the Blood Moon stuff is essentially just more valuable versions and more expensive versions of the basic stuff. So right. you run into these decision trees where it's like, oh, am I going to put this into my plot now, or am I going to wait and hope that the Blood Moon comes up next turn and not skip a turn? And you've only got 6 spots in your garden, and you can fill that up because only plants get sold. So you could accidentally, fill yourself up with fertilizer spots and chickens and goats, and all of a sudden find yourself unable to grow any plants.
And another neat mechanic that we didn't call out when we were kind of giving the game overview is everything you sell just goes back into the market. So I actually like that the same plants will be in the game for the whole game, and they kind of just rotate in and out. Every round, there'll be new stuff added to that market, but everything you sell is now available for someone else to buy, which is another neat part to the decision tree. Mm-hmm. Now, another thing that might not have been obvious from the overview, though I think it is the way the round structure works that ends up adding a push your luck element. Because you don't know if the game's going to be 4 rounds or more. Roses are probably one of the best cards in the game, but they take 3 whole rounds to water and produce. And while it's round 3, do I buy a rose? How many Blood Moons have come up already? Is the game going to go 5 rounds, or am I going to get stuck with this thing that I spent water on and I spent fertilizer on and I spent money on that I'll never be able to sell? That variable game length adds this like feeling of tension and push or luck aspect.
Yeah, I like that timing mechanic where you're flipping up a weather card each round. And as we said, if you flip up 3 Blood Moons in a row, the game is over in round 4, or you might end up playing the longest game possible, which could be 6 rounds. And once you've played the game a bit and you're aware that you have that variable length, you end up having to adapt your gameplay so that you're changing what you're doing based on what's already come up and how much you want to push your luck that the next card won't end the game. And I like that aspect. I find it really interesting. It's part of what draws me to the game.
Yeah, and you've got the option to, play it safe. Maybe you only grow things that take a round or 2 to play, and you're playing it safe and trying to maximize your turnover as opposed to, taking those big risks. It all depends your ability to be risk or risk averse. Is there in the game. You've got that ability.
And then you throw in the asymmetric powers, and it gets even more interesting, right? Because one of the powers is someone that gets to water a plant twice. But if they do that, they have to water someone else's plant twice, but only if you keep a water in the well. So if that character's in play, you're going to change your gameplay and maybe push your luck and get that rose, and then make sure you always leave a water in your well just in case, because you don't want to give that player a free water. And then you kind of play the same game with the fertilizer sometime. And then one of the other things is the deck is pretty thick. You will not see all the cards. So you might go the entire game with no watering can to produce extra water. Or you might play the entire game and never see a flower. We almost had that. We had a game round where only one flower came up the entire game. And the main scoring was based on upgrading your plots and end game points, which was neat. Now, I will say the game's not all roses. Like, pretty much everything we talked about so far has been positive. There are a few thorns. And the biggest one is the icons on the round tiles. There's these little arrows that kind of point in and out. So you have like a basket and it points in. And that's supposed to mean go to market and take tiles. And for the last thing, when you're selling, it's a basket with an arrow that's saying sell. Now, those never change. So it's honestly not that bad. You're going to remember, start of the round, you buy. At the end of the round, you sell. But then there's one for fertilizer that tells you fertilize your own plot or fertilize one of your 2 neighbors. That arrow is so hard to see, even with good eyesight. And it's one of those minor things, but they made it this little curvy arrow. Like if you just done a straight point down arrow, made it 2 points bigger, it just would have been better. I don't know. Why is this not more clear?
Yeah, and you sure as heck can't see it from across the table. Like the iconography everywhere else about that game is great. It's fantastic, actually. But that little arrow that shows where the fertilizer is going that round, it is far too tiny. It's highly annoying.
Yeah, it's at the point where I didn't realize it was an arrow until we got to that point in the game and Mo pointed out the fact that it was an arrow. Because, again, at a distance, even without decent eyes, it's a little squiggly thing.
And the other thing I found after playing many games, especially in the same week with different people, is that the game did start to feel a little samey to me. I don't know. I played a bunch of games in a row in 1 week. And while each game was unique, especially like I said, mentioned earlier with which tiles came up and which didn't, that to me added the most variety. And that whole thing where you never quite know where it's going to end. But after my fourth play in 3 days, I kind of had enough of the game. That said, it's now been long enough. We could go play tonight. Like, let's go to a coffee shop after we finish recording this episode. I'll happily play La Familia Hort. So maybe just don't binge this game. Don't play too many in a row. That might just be a little bit too much gardening for you.
It's a shorter game. I mean, it's a filler game. And we played it many times in a short period of time because we wanted to hurry up and review it in time for Halloween, right? So yep. I think normally your plays would end up spaced out. So each time it hits a table, it would still be enjoyable. But yeah, I'm not sitting down and playing this four or five times in a row.
Yeah, no, I think this is fantastic. This is one of those games that I think is going to be fantastic at the live play events, at our group events. It's like, hey, what have you got? We got friends coming, but we need to fill something. You know, we need to fill something for half an hour. Mm-hmm. Oh, hey, let's play La Familia Hort. You know, it's that sort of great game. It's that great filler game. The before the game night starts, if some people are there early, great game for that.
Yeah, I dig it. I'm glad Mark introduced it to us. I'll be totally honest. If it wasn't for Mark introducing us, yeah, the art's neat, but like, I don't know, this probably wouldn't have caught my attention. We probably would have missed this one. If I'd stumbled across this at my friendly local game store, I probably wouldn't have gave it a second look. I think that the game is fun. I like the creepy stuff, right? The Blood Moon, that just, it turns it from, it's not just another farming game into something unique and thematic and the ghost things. I think this is a great gateway game. I think it's good for families. The two levels of play is great for a learning curve where you can ramp up the difficulty. And honestly, there's enough depth here that it is fun for heavy gamers as well. Like, you got Dana here, who's our Feld fanatic, who was like, yeah, I like La Familia Hort, half hour, you know, Edward Gorey gardening game.
Yeah, I agree. I would not have picked this game. It probably would have flown under my radar. I tend to pick up a game, and if it says you can play it in 20 minutes, that's a really bad sign in my world, and I probably don't want to play it. This game is a filler game that is meaty enough, and it's enjoyable. I'm super glad Mark handed us a copy to check out.
So if you're looking for a seasonally appropriate spooky game with a unique theme, adding a copy of La Familia Hort to your collection just makes sense. Like, I know I'm bringing it out for our Halloween game night.
Yeah, I think of this more as a goth-style game than a horror personally. But if that's your aesthetic, you can add this to your collection as a filler or a light casual game. Now, while it might wear thin, as Mo was saying, if you played it as your go-to regular weekly game, as something that comes out now and then, it's a great one to have in the collection.
If you dig farming games in general, which I know there are actually a lot of you out there, here's a nice quick playing one with some familiar mechanics and a neat theme. It's a game just about buying, planting, watering, and fertilizing without any building of buildings or raising a family or exploring caves.
If your kids are into spooky games, this could be a good game for them or for a regular family game night. I am certain my girls would have loved this when they were 8 years younger. And to be fair, Gwen likes it now at 17. As for Jen, she's currently in a board games are dumb phase of being a teenager, so we didn't get her to play it, so I can't share her opinion.
Do you see what color it is outside? It looks like it's time for the final Blood Moon. I hope we did well enough on this review to make Granny Hortensia happy.
Here's the place where we ask you what your favorite games are that fit the theme or genre of our current review. Except this game really hits two different genres, spooky horror-themed games and farming games. And I guess kid-friendly games as well.
So I guess what we'll ask, here's a challenge for you. Let us know what your favorite combination of two of these are. I want to hear about spooky games great for the whole family. Farming games you can play with your kids. Or how about a horror farming game for adults? Is there such a thing? I really want to hear about that one, if that's a thing.
I do not want to hear about a horror farming game because what popped into my mind was truly horrific. Okay, there. Let us know your recommendations in the comments or on Discord or on social media, where we can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word.
Normally, you find the Minotaur living in the maze, but Stonespine Architects turns that upside down as you play Minotaurs who are competing to build the best dungeon.
Stonespine Architects, a role player tale, is a less than 1 hour, 1 to 5 player card drafting dungeon building board game from Thunderworks Games, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy.
Stonespine Architects comes from designer Jordi Aden, the designer of Cartographers, the Cartographers series of games, which is also published by Thunderworks. Cartographers is a flip-and-draw fantasy game that all of us enjoy quite a bit, and if you haven't seen it yet, I encourage you to check out our Cartographers review when you're done listening to this.
Stonespine Architects does have a few minor similarities to Cartographers, but is very much its own game. It's just the fact that you are building things and getting points for fulfilling randomly drawn requirements, and some of the icons are the same. That's where you find that hint of overlap.
And another similarity, I guess, is the fact that this is set in the Thunderworks role player universe, as are many of their games. So there's names and places that would overlap. So in Stonespine Architects, each player will be building a dungeon. This is represented by a 4x4 grid of dungeon cards, built one row at a time over four rounds, which represent in-game years. Now, between rounds, players get to go shopping for new features for their dungeons and purchase challenge cards, which are unique scoring opportunities. Players will also be competing for points based on a shared goal, as well as trying to make their dungeon match a randomly assigned blueprint card.
Each dungeon card in Stonespine Architects is one of two types, either cave or stone, and features a pathway which leads to up to four doorways on the edges of the card. Each card also displays up to four features, which are things like monsters, traps, treasure chests, or reputation points. And then at the bottom of each card, a gold value is listed.
Each round starts by players getting a hand of five cards. They choose one of these cards to place in their dungeon on any of the four spots in the current row. They then pass the rest of their cards to an opponent next to them, and the direction of which way you go changes each round. Players draft a card from their new hand and pass the rest until all have a full row of four cards.
Next, players add up all the coins showing at the bottom of the four cards they just added to their dungeon. And then they're going to add one to this for each treasure chest in their dungeon, not just in the row just played, their entire dungeon. This sets their gold total for the round. Players then use this gold to purchase new features for their dungeon.
The market is made up of a number of market cards which are filled with random tokens. Each market card will have two spots on it at different costs, which will hold one to three tokens of different types. The player with the most money gets to go shopping, their gold is adjusted, and then whoever now has the most money goes shopping, and it could be the same player.
The features you can buy match those which can be found on the cards. Different types of traps, monsters, treasure chests, and reputation tokens. In addition, there are also secret passages, which create a pathway between two cards or the edge of a dungeon where one doesn't already exist.
Now, at any point, when in this market phase, players can say, I'm done buying, I pass, I'm done. This sets their priority for the next round, and priority is mainly used for breaking ties, and lets them take one of the face-up challenge cards. Now, this will list some type of dungeon requirement and points for fulfilling that requirement. These are things like 3 points for every goblin in a column, or points for having full rows and columns of the same type of card, stone or cave, or having pairs of slimes and oozes in your dungeon, having full rooms, counting all the traps along a single path, and many, many more. It's a significant stack of these challenge cards.
Throughout the game, you will end up collecting a total of 3 challenge cards. You get one during each market phase at the end of rounds 1 to 3. It's actually a 4-round game, but you don't collect a challenge card in round 4. To get your final score, you total up the points awarded by your challenge cards, plus where you ended up on the priority track, plus how well you matched your blueprint card, plus the points for the shared objective, plus any renown points in your dungeon, and finally, how many of your dungeon rooms connect to your entrance and exit.
Now, when playing 2 players, the drafting rules change slightly. You still get 5 cards at the start of each round. You will play 1 to your dungeon, discard 1, and then the remaining cards to your opponent. Then you will each draw a card from the deck before choosing, discarding, and passing again. This adds a random element that makes the game a little less cutthroat to players.
Stonespine Architects also includes a full solo game, which has you challenging JL, an advisor to the Queen sent to check on your progress. JL collects chamber cards and market tokens, but doesn't actually build a dungeon, doesn't have a blueprint, and doesn't collect challenge cards. Instead, there's a specific deck for JL that you draw from each round that will tell you which cards he collects, how much gold he has for the round and what he'll buy, as well as presenting what he will score at the end of the game. What's nice is if you find JL a little too easy to beat, the game also includes some cards you can swap out of his deck for more difficult cards. And I think there's three of those, and you can kind of add one or two or three to kind of scale things up.
Now, all of that may have made the game sound way more complicated than it is. It's actually really quick to teach. The mechanics tie in really well to theme, and it's one of those games where you're just doing what makes sense, and it's very easy to remember. To help with that, the game includes two reference cards per player, which include all the icons. They're super helpful, very well laid out, and they have a walkthrough of the game round, etc.
There's even a quick setup reference on one side of one of the cards that we love.
Yeah.
Another great addition is the plastic box insert with a spot for everything, including sleeved cards and a tray for all of the tokens. This tray has a lid and is perfect for putting out on the table, making setup and put away nice and quick. Sorting the cards is quick due to each type of card having different card back. You can see all of this in the Stonespine Architects unboxing video on YouTube.
So we first saw Stonespine Architects in prototype form at Gamma Expo. It immediately caught my eye then. I'm like, okay, look, it's a dungeon building game. It looks cool. It looks like a dungeon. Like I'm seeing gelatinous cubes. And sorry, they're not called that in the game. They don't use that term, but they're gelatinous cubes. And there's oozes and there's goblins and kobolds and treasure and traps. And it just looks cool. We got an overview of the game then at a Media First Look event. And honestly, I would have happily taken a copy home at that point, but it wasn't ready. It was still just a prototype. So instead, we agreed right then and there that we will take a copy of the finished product home if they have it at Origins, which they did, which was awesome. So thanks, Thunderworks, for that, setting that up. There we got to see group after group enjoying this game. The Thunderworks booth had four tables going all con long, and I don't think I ever saw an empty seat. There was always people playing this game.
Yeah, I have to say, if I hadn't already been sold on the game, seeing how much folks were enjoying it at Origins would have totally won me over to wanting to try it.
And now that we've unboxed our copy and got to the table, I fully understand why those tables were full. I bet you a lot of that was word of mouth. People are playing that game, then going to their friends and saying, you got to try this. Because after that first game with some local gamers at a public play event, I was hooked. Like that was good enough that I'm like, okay, D, we have to play this weekend. We're going out of town on Sunday. I'm bringing this game. We are going to try this two player. And by the end of first week, I had played five times. And honestly, I'd like, let's go. Come on. Is this on Board Game Arena? Can we play while we're recording? Like, this one has me hooked.
I have to say, the game was easy enough that I sat down, started playing. And while those reference cards were sitting out there right next to me, I never actually looked at them because it just makes sense.
Yeah, there's like a simplicity and elegance to the game mechanics. It just, they work. You're building a dungeon. It just makes sense. And then there's the fact you're building something. And I like that feeling in a game. I like the feeling of accomplishment. I am building something. At the end of the game, I want to take a picture of even if I didn't do social media and reviews, I'd still want to take a picture of my dungeon to go, look at my dungeon. Look at how I made all the paths connect. Oh, I don't want to be a hero coming in this way. That would be horrible. Look at all those traps. And honestly, I think this grows even more when you manage to pull off some stuff, right? Like, so your blueprint card has eight different requirements on it. Finishing the game going, boom, 20 points. I completed my whole blueprint. Feels great. And the one I personally always take pride in, and I don't know why. One thing, I'm obsessed with making sure that you can reach my entrance and exit. And if I can get every corridor, every card to reach both, I am so happy at the end of the game. Like, that's my personal goal every time I play. It doesn't matter what's on my blueprint. I want every entrance and exit to connect.
And having every single room connected is way harder than it sounds. My Minotaur clearly doesn't understand hallways. I suspect they smash through walls when I'm not looking.
Now, everyone knows I love asymmetry in games. And I don't know, I wouldn't call this an asymmetric game, but there's an asymmetric element because it's kind of backwards, right? It's a little wonky. Like, asymmetry generally in a game means you start with different powers or resources or different starting stuff. Everyone starts off differently. Well, in this, you start off exactly the same. Everyone's exactly the same. But as you play, it becomes asymmetric. Now, yes, there's the what cards you play in everyone's dungeon is going to be unique. That's not what I mean. What I mean here is those challenge cards. While you are playing, you personally will decide what you're going to score. And that's going to be completely different from everyone else. In my dungeon, goblins may matter. In Deanna's dungeon, who cares how many goblins there are? Except for the fact there's a shared goal which maybe if it's who has the least goblins, then we both do care about our goblins. There is a shared goal. But other than that, every player is going to score a completely different set of things in their own dungeon, except for those connected passages.
Yeah, though everyone does have that different blueprint at the start, so you don't even really start off the same. That blueprint determines where your entrance is, where your exit is, and what kind of monsters you need, what kind of makeup your dungeon is going to be. Is it going to be more caves, more stone? Be aware, though, that aside from drafting, you're not able to impact other dungeons in any direct manner. It's quite competitive, but unlike cartographers, no one else can mess with your physical layout.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you all start off the same, but you just branch off and you end up doing your own thing, and you don't tend to be overly competing for the same goal. I like it.
Yeah, one of my favorite parts, and I love the market mechanic in this game. The way the market is generated with these random cards, you never know exactly what's going to be available and how many things will be available. You always know how many different purchases are possible because every card has two ways to buy on them. But like sometimes it's a single trap, and then the next time it might be three monsters, or it could be three tokens. And I really like the way that works. I do dig that market phase and trying to decide, do I want to add more features to my dungeon? But then there's that whole thing with the challenge cards. And some challenge cards are not, the challenge cards aren't all created equal. So do I add some features to my dungeons to better match my goal or the blueprint or my existing challenge cards? Or do I give those all to my opponents so I can draft the challenge card that just like seems easy? I've already got three kobolds in a row. Oh man, I need that kobolds in a column card badly. The problem is everyone else knows that. If they're paying attention, if they look over at my board, they're going to see this. And I like that aspect. I really dig that. And every round features one more card than the number of players. So you're never stuck, like you're stuck with that card. It's always, you still get a choice, but it's often worth passing early to get that card that perfectly matches.
Yeah, I enjoy the way the timing works for the market, where if you have enough money, you might be able to get two purchases in before anyone else even takes a turn, or you can make a purchase and still pass in time to get that challenge card that you really want. I also like the almost playing chicken aspect of guessing how much you can get away with buying and still have a chance at the challenge card that you want. Like, do you play it safe and just pass? Or can I guess which card Sean wants and think he's probably not going to grab that one anyways? Or if he is, he's going to buy that thing over there first because he definitely wants goblins. So I'm probably safe to make one purchase. Like, I like that you end up trying to make all those educated guesses.
Another thing I like here is the game length, especially with the amount of thinking and depth for a short game. Like, you get that I built something in under an hour.
The game's on the lighter side and it's relatively quick, but it still gives you the I played a full game kind of feeling. Like, there's a sense of completion. Hey, I built a thing. It doesn't leave you thinking, dear God, if only there was one more round in this game. I'm so frustrated that I didn't run my engine. You know, like, it feels complete.
Yeah, the fact that you're building this 4x4 grid and you know right up front everyone's doing, it's the same thing. You're doing four rounds and you're doing four per round. It feels right. It feels complete. I didn't feel like it was too fast. I didn't feel like it overstayed its welcome. It really does kind of sit in a nice groove for length.
As for complaints, because, you know, it can't all be positive, I honestly don't have much to add. It's nice. It's good. The biggest problem I found is sometimes people don't understand something about the scoring, because you heard our list. Hey, plus this, plus this, plus this, plus this. It's a point salad, I guess, really. There's a lot of different things you score on, and I've had people miss some of it, or those challenge cards. They can be misread. You can totally read a card wrong, thinking, oh, it means goblins and oozes in the same room when it means your whole dungeon. Or people don't understand, and I forget the term, chambers, whatever it is, for groups of cards. There's a way you group the cards. I've had people misunderstand that. I've had multiple players forget that you are going to get points at the end of the game for all your rooms that connect to your entrance and exit. And that's big, because you get one for each. So like, if a room connects to both, that's 2 points per room. And then priority, that's the thing that's set by how quick you pass when purchasing things, which in addition to getting a card to set your priority, Well, the last round of the game, that priority gives points. And it's like 8 points for whoever's highest in priority. And I've seen people totally forget that. The worst that I've seen is someone misunderstanding their blueprint card. And the problem with this one is you don't know until the very end of the game. Whereas when I'm playing with someone and it looks like they're misunderstanding a challenge card, I can look over and I see them putting, you know, goblins in rows instead of columns and be like, you realize that only scores if they're in columns, right? Well, the blueprint, you won't see that till the very end. And that can be almost like heartbreaking, right? You get to the very end of the game and they're like, oh, I thought that meant this. It means something else. So groups of rooms are called clusters. I got to thank our chat room for the correction there.
And the thing with the priority, too, is realizing that that is the tiebreaker for that last everything. Round. And you end up being pretty close. So when you're going to score at the very end, having the priority for the tie breaking can be pretty important.
Yep. Now, my recommendation for this is to, sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Sorry.
So my recommendation to deal with this is the player who knows the game the best. Just make sure you walk everyone through the goal, right? Like the goal that's face up that everyone's doing, make sure everyone understands it. Point out things like for most, you have to have at least one to score it all. For least, you can have zero accounts. That one's important. And then every time a challenge card comes up, talk it over as a group so you make sure you're all on the same page. Because you put them up before anyone's taking any turns, right? So you're going to flip up the player count plus one. Just read them off. Read them off and go, everyone understand that one? Everyone understand that one? Everyone understand that one? And when teaching the game, I recommend strongly grab a blueprint that isn't used, one that the players don't have, bottom of the deck, whatever, and kind of put it out and show it off to explain what all the icons on it mean. Now, you're not going to cover everything because the blueprints are different. Some show traps, some show monsters, some show reputation tokens, different corridor types, and so on. But that's what I recommend so you don't have this, because that is where I've seen the game break down.
Yeah, I think the biggest risk for players and the gotcha that everyone should really be looking out for is forgetting the path connecting your front, your doors and on all that. That can really be a big deal because there is a lot to keep track of with your blueprint, with the three challenges out there. But among all those things, there's no real reminder about that path scoring. And because of that, it's easy for a new player to let that aspect slip while they're focusing on all the other scoring aspects of the game. So really try and focus on that with new players and make sure you maybe even just, you know, bring it up at one point. Hey, do you remember about paths?
So overall, I think it's pretty clear at this point. I really dig this game. Honestly, this is in my best of 2024. Like this is one of the best games I played all year. This is the game that after we played it the first time, I kept showing it to people. Like this was the new hotness for me. I was like, oh, you got to try this game. Oh, you're at Walkerville. You got some time here. I'll show you Stonespine. Hey, D, we're going to bring this out on date night because we want to play some Stonespine. I have played this game the most in the shortest amount of time for any game of this year. It's been a hit with my family. It's been a hit with my friends, local gamers. I think more importantly, no one's gotten sick of it. I haven't gotten anyone said, okay, let's play Stonespine. Like, yeah, let's play something else. And there's just so much variability and replayability that every game has felt unique. And I love dealing with a totally different set of goals every game, especially since you get to pick them. I really dig that aspect of you get to choose what you're scoring or you buy lots of market cards and get stuck with something.
Yeah, I think the ease of both getting it to the table and up and playing with the easy teach and nice component organization really helps this game, as the playtime isn't vastly offset by the setup and teardown. It can always be frustrating when you're sitting down to an hour-long game, but then you've also got a half hour of setup and teardown as well on top of that.
Yeah, I totally agree. I love how quick this is to get to the table, how easy it is to explain to new players. I love that we can play this lighter game in like under an hour and still have that I played a real game feeling. I've enjoyed it, but I'm not as excited about it as Mo is.
Now, as for the Cartographer fan, same designer, so I think it's worth mentioning, you're going to dig this, right? Well, it's a very different game. There are some similarities. And like I get the feeling, I'm like, yeah, I can tell this is from the same designer. There's definitely some overlap. Of course, the big difference in Cartographers, everyone has the same input. And you're trying to share the same features. You're all scoring the same thing. On this, you're each doing your own thing, except for one shared goal. Everyone will be scoring completely differently.
People who get frustrated with having to draw features in Cartographers will also appreciate that this card-driven game has no artistic talent required.
And to be fair, that actually speeds up gameplay, because drawing takes time. Now, if you're a Seven Wonders, Sushi Go, Among the Stars fan, or a fan of other card drafting games, you should love Stonespine Architects. It has all the interaction, drafting, and hate drafting of those games with a totally new theme where you get to decide in part what you want to score.
For everyone else, I strongly recommend giving this game a shot, especially if you dig fantasy games, and more so if you love the idea of building a dungeon. Heck, RPG DMs may want to check this out as a potentially fun way to be able to play a board game and then use the end result as inspiration for your dungeon in your current campaign. And with that, our review of Stonespine Architects is done, and it's time for Master Hortgully to judge our work. Hopefully we scored top marks and can earn the title of Master Architect.
If you thought we made the grade, be sure to thumbs up, like, and reshare this review. Leave a comment to let us know what you liked best, and be sure to share your opinion of the game if you've gotten to try it.
Now, I would also love to hear what your favorite game from Thunderworks Games is. I'm a big fan of role player. I really enjoy Cartographers, and now, personally, can't get enough Stonespine. Is there something else we should be looking to check out from them? Comment, hit us up on social media, or post something on our Discord.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end, and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons. Ron F. Thank you, Ron.
Brian Van Beek. Thank you, Brian.
William Fisher. Thank you.
Andrew Dacey. Thank you, Andrew.
Danielle and Owen Thomas. Thanks, folks.
Sean P. Kelly. Thank you, fellow Sean. Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Again, I'm going to say probably the single thing we would most love in the universe right now is reviews. If you enjoy the show, please head over to Spotify, Pandora, Apple Podcasts, wherever you listen, and leave us a review and help others discover our show.
And one way you can show your love and possibly get someone else to go, what's that, is check out the Tabletop Bellhop merch at tabletopbellhop.com/merch. Now, anyone who's joined us for a live show knows we run on coffee. That is the fuel that keeps the creativity coming. One of the things you can do to keep those juices flowing is support the show by buying us a cup of joe. Just head over to tabletopbellhop.com/coffee. Heck, if you really love us, you can set up a monthly coffee donation.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.